The Imani Speak Show.
Greetings, 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 kings and queens. Imani is back in the house this Wednesday evening at 8 o'clock, and I'm feeling so wonderful, so blessed, just so blessed to be here with you tonight. So we're going to start with playing some music, just get you in the right frame of mind, the right zone. We're going to be playing some Sandra Hurst, a great teacher, great mentor. Someone that I really, you know, sort of made a difference to my life and gave me the inspiration to do some of what I'm doing now. If you want to call in, the live link number is 0580183483. I'll repeat that, 07580183483. And you can also send us an email if you like at nubiahouseradio@gmail.com, nubiahouseradio@gmail.com. And you can also go to our Facebook page, Nubia House. So enjoy the music and let's get this show on the road. I have a special guest for you this evening. They're not here yet. They'll probably be coming in after 9 sometime. I hope they actually can make it because they're really busy and lots of things they're doing. But let's play some music and I'll tell you more about it.
Shabba-dee-wah.
Yeah. here alone with a lover unlike no other. Sad to see a new horizon slowly coming into view. Yeah, I wanna be living for the love of you. Oh, yes, I am. All that I'm giving is for the love of you. All right now. Ooh, lovely as a ray of sun. Ooh, that touches me when the morning comes, feels good to me. Yeah, my love and me. Well, smoother than a gentle breeze, blowing through my mind with ease, soft as can be. Well, when you're loving me. Riding the waves of your love, enchanted with your touch, and it seems to me we could sail together in and out of mystery. Well, I wanna be living for the love of you. All right now, all that I.
Thank you. sugar. It ain't no telling what I'm gonna do. What a feeling. Feeling good, feeling like you never felt. Just like ice cream. And honey, my love is gonna make you melt.
So what the fence is? Just let me be close to you.
Let me be close to you.
I'm so proud to have you for my girl.
Hello. I'm having such a fun time. Oh, all those old tunes, they now bring back all the memories. I hope you've enjoyed them as well. And what can I say? I'm just so glad to be back. I was away last week. I don't know if you noticed. I think we played a recording of a previous show. But I went to see my new granddaughter. So I've got four now. And it was such a blessing to be down there with my daughter, husband, and the four grandchildren. It was really lovely. So, you know, it's just made me think, you know, when you get this brand new person coming into, you know, into your life, into your world, into, you know, the family. And it's, you know, a blank sheet, you know, just an amazing experience. And just to hold that small person with all that, you know, all that future ahead, all that hope, all those, you know, dreams, you know, their purpose. And you just, you know, you just feel, wow, you know, this is an amazing experience. It's a miracle. And we don't really realise how, you know, children, you know, babies being born is are a miracle. And that we need to nurture them and really sort of, you know, make sure that we're sowing seeds into their life that is positive. So, yeah, I was, you know, very excited to have a great time there. So, yeah, so my show this week, actually, what I wanted to just discuss is the format. What I'm going to start doing is splitting my show into, say, hour periods. The show next week, I'm probably going to do a 2-hour with that particular show. But in future, my feelings are that I'd like to split it into 2 hours, sort of like, so I could have either two guests or I will do a segment as well, just playing music for you as I've done. And just playing some of the really important or, you know, cool inspirational things, audios like Sandra Hurst, which I'm about to play for you. Now, I'm going to give you the live link number again. It's 07-580-183-483 if you want to call in and just make your opinions, your voice heard. Because that's what I'd like. I'd like, you know, want this show, as I said when I started all those months ago, this show is just not, it's not just my show, it's our show. So, you know, here, your opinions count. Want to hear from you. So feel free to call in or text in, or you can send an email to newbierhouseradio@gmail.com, or you can catch us on the Newbier House Facebook page. So yeah, so I'm going to play some Sandra Hurst, because for me, I just feel she covers everything. You know, she does the wealth creation, health, relationships. And so I'm going to play you a few segments from her audio, and we can enjoy that together. And maybe, if you'd like, we can have a discussion about it. So I'm going to play that for you now. So I hope you enjoy. And remember to get your papers and pens, because there's always so much to learn from Sandra Hurst. So let's go now.
Tell us about relationships and money. How does an abundance or a lack of money affect the way we as black men and women relate to each other?
Okay, well, let's go again. I like to put this in the historical context. See, when the enslavers came into Africa, what they did was really knock down our twin towers, yes? And that twin tower essentially was the female tower in that relationship. And this was quite crucial, because our societies always worked in cooperation, not in competition, yes? So we always had a matriarchal society. So when the enslavers came, who were largely patriarchal and not wanting to recognize the strength of the women, it was inherent in them that they would separate us and keep us apart, yes? Hello?
I'm tuning in.
Even during slavery, the main agitators were women, you know, although men went out and, you know, agitated. But through slavery, see, when the women became pregnant, it was because she was enslaved, her child became enslaved. So it wasn't through the male that the male, you know, the male would sire many, many children. Even, you know, they wouldn't say, well, just because you've sired this child, that child would become enslaved. It was through the women. What we have to understand, that there's been a conscious effort basically to keep us apart, and obviously to keep us against each other. Like I said, if you look at any, go back to Egypt and look at any of the carvings and the insignias, there's always a male and female energy. So this is critical as well. So as I said, we're not in competition. We have to start looking in cooperation. Uh-huh. And if you look at the word material, that comes from mater, woman, yes? Inheritance, it is, yes?
Uh-huh.
So the female line is very, very critical. But the point of having a balanced relationship is that we have roles within the relationship. So the roles are, the males are there to protect and provide for us, yes?
Yes.
The family. And it's the female role to then take that provision, bless that, to grow it, and then to bring that back into the home, to nurture the home. So you find that it's the women. So the men would go and, for example, plant the seed, grow the yam, bring the yam to the woman, and then would, you know, agree a price to pay the man X amount. She would then take that produce, go to the market and sell that. The excess that she has, she buys some more seed, gives that to the man, and then the rest would go into the home. So that's a very kind of very basic example, if you like, yes? But this is our role. So this is why we need the balance between us. So this way, sometimes men would say, oh, this woman, oh, she, you know, you're looking at a man that can provide and protect you. But because we've forgotten our roles, you know, we're now told, oh, women, we can do everything that we want, you know, because I've been down the women's lib route as well, and yes, you know, we don't need a man, but we do, because without that balance, we don't have the proper energy. We cannot do it on our own. So, you know, this is what the 100-year plan is talking about. So I'm talking about rebuilding or building those foundations, male-female energy. So the male and female energy is, you know, like I say, if you look in, my parents are from Jamaica, you look at who runs the markets in Jamaica, it's women.
Yes.
You go to Africa, Ghana, it's the women that runs the markets, yes? It's because of that energy, that's our role, yeah? So it's, this is why women will look to men who can protect them and who can provide, but because we've forgotten how to invest and grow that money, then we kind of lose the plot a bit. So it looks as though we're just looking for men on a materialistic point, but it isn't. It's because we use that to nurture and grow.
I went back to it recently and started to look at sex because I was on what happened. I was speaking on another station. I can't remember which one it was. And an issue came up about... So I was talking about relationships and money. That's it. And I'm talking about relationships and money in terms of... Again, in terms of the 100-year plan and in terms of how we need to organise ourselves around money. And this issue always comes up, you know, does money break up relationships? And I'm saying, well, it's not the money that breaks up relationships. It must be the relationship. Because if this room was filled with money, it wouldn't do anything unless you did something with it. Because in and of itself, it has no power, yeah, no energy, you know, unless you do something with it, yeah? So that made me start looking at this whole thing about relationships, but then come down to, obviously, relationships are about sex as well. So sex transmutation. So what was so important about sex transmutation that Napoleon Hill had to write about it? This was in the 1920s that he wrote this book. Transmutation, so I had to look up transmutation. Transmutation is basically changing one thing into another. So one of the definition in the dictionary was using the thing about alchemy. So what do alchemists do? The alchemists attempt to transmute base metals like lead and bronze into gold and silver. You know, that's the whole point of alchemy. Alchemy, as we know, chemistry, chem, comes from chemet. So this has, you know, so this got me thinking now, all right, so this has something deeper to do with us, yeah? So sex transmutation. So I'm looking at sex. I'm looking at... Dr. Africa, what does he say about sex? Now, Dr. Africa saying sex, the purpose of sex is procreation, creation, yeah? Sex transmutation for Napoleon Hill is about creation, it's about creative power. So what he's saying essentially in Think and Grow Rich is that sex, the motivation actually, is not sex itself, but the motivation and desire for sex is one of the most powerful human desires and motivators, yes? So if you're using sex or using that energy, that motivation to do something creative with it, that is when you're going to the moon. So what he's saying is that the people that he talked to, they waited or they didn't realize until they were in their 40s and 50s the power of that sexual drive, the power of using or transforming that sexual drive that they'd been using as teenagers in their 20s and 30s to sow their wild oats, to have, you know, different women and dally with it. When they started to concentrate that energy into creative power, they went clear. Yeah? So I said, all right. So if sex is that... That's just one of the things about creative power, yeah? So hold that there. So I'm looking at Dr. Africa now, and he says, the purpose of sex is creation, procreation, not recreation. So we're using it as recreation. So it's dissipating. We're wasting energy. We're wasting power.
All right, so imagine you have a family, husband and wife, and they have two children. How would they start to begin to create wealth for themselves? What kind of investment vehicles, as you say, should they choose?
Right. Again, I'm not a financial advisor in the sense that I don't tell people how to what to invest in that sense. So what I would suggest with any family that's really serious about creating wealth and building wealth in their life, which any family can do, is really to, the first thing is, and I always come back to this, is really find out what your purpose is. What is your purpose as a family, and what is then, how does money, how will money help you to get to some of those things in your purpose? So, for example, the family, as you say, if it's, you know, husband and wife and two children, or a couple and two children, depending on the ages of the children, they might want them to go to school, or they may want them to travel, you know, three times a year. So you list all the things that you want, yes, and have no limits on that. So if you want a bigger house, you know, typically people I speak to are quite modest, actually, in what they want. So they want maybe a bigger house, maybe a different car, like you say, you know, have some savings and just do some of the things they want to do as a family.
Yes.
That's quite modest. But if once you start writing that down, once you start creating your purpose, and this is one of the things I work with on an individual basis or with families or with groups, is to really find out how to write your purpose. And there's like a little technique that I have that you can find that. Then once you find that, then you find out what the best vehicle is.
Is that a technique? Sorry to cut you. Is that a technique you could share with us?
It is a bit long to share.
It's a bit long. Okay, then.
We'll
skip that. Yeah.
I will hopefully come up to Birmingham and share that with you.
Yeah, most certainly. Most certainly.
But so, for example, if a family has young children that they want to send to university in 10 years' time, for example, there's a particular vehicle, for example, like second-hand endowment policies. So once a policy has been created and somebody sells their policy, it's possible to buy that policy, because a policy doesn't cease because you've sold it. It only ceases at the mature date. And there's a whole market where you can look at policies, you can decide what the premium is, when the maturity date is, and you can start planning your life around the maturity dates of these policies.
Yeah.
So, for example, you could buy a policy today that matures in 10 years' time. So you know in 10 years' time, that policy, when it matures, you're going to get 20,000 or 10,000 or 15. And then you buy another policy next year that matures in 10 years. So you can do this for the next 5 years. And so from year 10 to 15, every year you'd have a policy maturing at maybe 10,000, 15,000. So you can start, you know, gearing, if you like, a future event now, yes?
Yeah.
So that when your children start university, you know that you're getting 10,000 in year 10. Yeah, does that make sense?
Yes, for me it does. I hope so. It makes sense to you out there, listeners.
Yeah, well, that's just one vehicle.
Six. Very important subject. Why is it important? There's a book called Think and Grow Rich. You might have come across that.
I've heard of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's by an author called Napoleon Hill.
Okay.
And he was assigned this project by Andrew Carnegie, because Andrew Carnegie got quite wealthy, partly through Rothschild's money as well, I must say.
Why does that name sound so familiar?
He left a lot of his money to public goods when he died. So he built lots of libraries and public institutions.
Okay,
he made his money through building railways and through steel in America, essentially.
Okay.
But he started off as a poor Scottish man that went to America and did really well. So he wanted Napoleon Hill to really do a survey, if you like, of wealthy people in America at that time, wealthy and, as I suppose, important people, and find out what were the kind of common denominator to wealth, really. Finding out, well, if there is a common denominator, anyone can use this. You know, what were the characteristics that you needed? What were the kind of skills? If there were connections, you know, all these kinds of things he wanted to kind of really kind of put in a big pot, if you like, and see what came out. So Napoleon Hill took on this this challenge, if you like, because he was doing it, he wasn't getting paid to do it, and it took him quite a few years to do it. But anyway, as I said, he wrote this book, Think and Grow Rich, and it basically came down to what we're talking about in terms of the psychology of the wealth. I mean, in terms of making plans, setting goals, being persistent, you know, just kind of standing up and doing those things. But one chapter that he had was called Sex Transmutation.
Sex Transmutation.
Right. So, like I said, one of the areas of people activity is sex. So, having read Napoleon Hill, having read Dr. Francis Creswell Singh, looking at the whole issue around sex, having read Neely Fuller, because he has a chapter on sex as well in terms of the nine areas of people activity, I had to kind of sift all this information together. So I'm looking at Napoleon Hill with Sex Transmutation, and I thought, why has he put this chapter in at this in this book? Because when I read the book first, I read the book first probably about 15, 18 years ago, and it kind of, you know, I read it and yeah, it made sense, did it, and I left it. And then, you know, doing this work I'm doing, and then I'm looking at, I looked at this book again, I'm saying, well, really, let me kind of dissect this, because again, I read everything I can, I read as much as I can, you know, taking as much information as I can, but I always try and relate it to our people and what, you know, my situation and my people's situation. So what does this mean for us? You know, how does this really affect us? You know, how can I use this information to take us to the next level or take myself to the next level?
So the first rule of investing is do not invest money that you can't afford to lose.
Okay. Yeah? Yeah.
Do not invest money that you can't afford to lose. So you don't start investing your mortgage money, your rent money, your food money. Yes, you start setting up, and I spoke before about the savings law and setting up the seven different savings accounts, yeah? You must have an investment saving account, yes, that you put money in that you are strictly going to use for investment. The second rule of investing is have a money management system. So, for example, if you have £5,000 in your investment account, you do not put that £5,000 on one item or one vehicle or buy one stock with that, yeah?
Yes.
You pace it out so that you have, you maybe, you know, 10% you spend on, I don't know, stock, for example, or, you know, you limit it to so much per month, yeah? So that you're in the game for a longer period. Okay. And then any gains that you make, you reinvest that back into your investment account, but you also put it into some of your other accounts as well.
Uh-huh.
Yeah? You start managing it differently. Because investment is a long-term thing. And I also spoke about investment in terms of the couple because, as I say, the male role, from an African point of view, is to provide and to protect the family. Yes?
Uh-huh.
To provide for the family and to protect the family. The female role is to use that provision to invest and to nurture the family. So you find that women are better investors, if you like, than men.
Typically. I'm glad you said that.
Typically, because, no, that's our role. If you look at, I mean, my parents come from Jamaica, for example, so you go to the market in Jamaica and it's women that run the market.
I'm glad you said, because I was just going to touch upon that. Whenever I've been to the Caribbean or Africa, you always see the women managing the money.
Yes.
You see them out in the markets.
That's
They're very
right.
active. Very,
that
very
right.
active.
So, yeah, so that is our role because we know how to follow rules. I mean, even in the stock market here, I've gone to many stock market courses here, and men say, you know, women follow the rules. This is what you do, A, B, C, D. Men tend to kind of jump. They want to do this. They don't want to do the paper trading and da, da, da. I mean, you know, risk is involved in everything, but men tend to not to want to follow the rules for whatever reason. But their role is typically, so again, if you go to Ghana, you know, women are running the markets there. You find Nigeria, it's the same thing. And we had a system here called the partner system in the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm. And, you know. My mum used to run one, actually.
Exactly. Do you know any men that ran a partner system?
No, not at all.
No, it's always the women. So this is our, you know, our natural way of being. So it's to work in cooperation with each other. Yeah, the Western system has tried to divide us away from each other so that, you know, we're looking as though we're in competition and women are just looking at men for money. Yes, we are looking at them for money to provide so that we can create, so we can invest it to make more for the family.
Yes.
So that, does that make sense?
Yeah, most certainly.
Yeah. So that those are really the two crucial rules. And the other rule for investing is invest in things that you love. So as I said, there's so many different vehicles out there. And, you know, well, I'll mention a couple. So we look at property, it's a typical vehicle that people understand. I mentioned the stock market. I mentioned second-hand endowment policies, art, there's gold. There's all kinds of ways that you can invest. But you have to really find what you love. And there's, you know, there's no reason as a family, the family example that you use, there's no reason that you can invest in more than one thing. Yeah?
Okay.
So if you're going to buy artwork, for example, buy original artwork by African artists, you know, that you're going to enjoy having and looking, but also that's going to increase in value, yes, over the years.
Uh-huh.
You know, if it's in a car, you know, make sure it's a car that's going to, you know, increase in value. You know, I heard of somebody the other day that bought one of these old cars and did it up and sold it for like 10 times the amount that he got it for.
Mm.
But there's lots of different ways that you can invest. But as I say, it's finding out what you want and why you want to invest.
Tell us, how do we then, because obviously money is one of those things that for some people, it does affect many relationships.
It's not that affects it so much as the expectation.
That comes
so
with
I
it.
I would say, first of all, you have to look at yourself.
Uh-huh.
So if you're in an unsatisfactory relationship, or you've been in unsatisfactory relationships, it's about you.
Yes.
What is it about you that have attracted that person into your life or those people into your life? So if you want something different, you have to start attracting different people, and you have to start working on yourself. So a lot of it is to do with decluttering. So you have to declutter a lot of that emotional baggage, a lot of physical baggage, and a lot of material baggage as well.
Okay.
So you will get what you want. Yeah. So, you know, I don't want someone to beat me. I don't want someone who does this. I don't want this. No, what do you want? So you can write a whole list of things that you don't want. Then on the other side, write what you do write. Write the antithesis of that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then you will get what you want.
Okay. So,
and so you have to look at yourself.
So to people who are currently in relationships now where money might be a big, big issue for them, to the point where they might even be considering breaking up because they can reconcile their differences around money. What advice would you give to them?
That might be the best thing for them to do because money is not the issue. If there's a money problem,
uh-huh.
If you have a money problem, money is not the problem. Yes?
Uh-huh.
If you think you have a money problem, money is not the problem. It's to do with your psychology. So you can use that as an excuse because you take the money away. All right, take the situation. You're in a relationship and your partner says to you, and Cobia, you know, £50,000 worth of debt, what would your reaction be?
Oh, if he comes
and says...
That
you didn't know about.
Oh, we can talk about that. There must be a reason. If he hasn't told me, there's a reason why, so...
Okay.
Let's talk.
And if he comes to you again, the next thing says, and Cobia, I've got £50,000 in a bank account that I never told you about. How would you feel about that?
He could most certainly talk about that too.
But it's the same feeling. It doesn't matter if it's plus or minus. The key thing is about the trust.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
But you would think, well, why has he told me that he's got all this? Or why has he told me that he's got this money? Or why has he got this money and we're struggling?
Yeah.
What do you think? Yeah?
Uh-huh.
Hello, hello, hello. Oh, my God. Wasn't that so uplifting and so empowering? I mean, Sister Sandra there, you know, just teaching on wealth creation and, you know, how we can, how, you know, it affects relationships. And just really want to know from yourselves if anyone wants to call in or text in or send a Facebook message, what have you. 07580183483, or you can email us at newbeerhouseradio@gmail.com, or you can text us at that same number, 07580183483. So yes, investments. I mean, for me, you know, investing in yourself, investing in improving, or you know, what you already have. We all come here, I believe, with gifts. Like I was saying about my little grandbaby coming here, you know, woven into her is her own gifts, her own purpose, you know, what she's obviously not conscious of at the moment, but that is going to start coming through as she gets older. And we all are, we all have this, we all are geniuses with our own gifts from within, whether we realize it or not. And it's about investing in that. But what I would also say, what I feel is really, really important as well, is how we talk to ourselves, our self-talk. It might, you know, I'm not talking about, you know, going mad, but we all have an inner world, an inner conversation that is always going on. And we need to check ourselves on that, because that is what is creating our lives, whether we know it or not. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, so I think we've got a call coming through, so we're just sorting that out. But yes, as I was saying, you know, it's so important for us to invest in ourselves, and also to. Oh right, okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. Hello, caller. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Hello.
Oh hi. Yeah. Hi. We're not used to having. Calls, so I got a bit muddled there. So what did you think? Did you hear actually the call that the audio that I played? Can you hear me?
I think this program that you're doing is very is a very powerful program for the community.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you. So what were your thoughts on what Sandra had to say?
I personally, anyway, this is this Brother Hash calling.
Brother Hash, yeah.
I believe that most of the a lot of the challenges that we have in the black community,
mm-hmm.
and even to do with even relationship problems that
mm-hmm.
we have in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not saying everyone is having relationship problems, but even to the most of the issues that is related to, you know, relationship issues, bad marriages and all that, it's a lot to do with financial situations and lack of economic understanding.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that there should be more of this kind of programs in the community,
right.
To educate us, our communities, to know how money really, really works.
Mm-hmm.
Because no one teaches this subject in schools.
Mm-hmm.
And as important as money and finances is, if money is very important thing in the community in our everyday life, but nobody really teaches us in schools anything about money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how does money work? Where does money come from? How mm-hmm. does it get created? Who creates the money? You know what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
So I think the more of this kind of programs in the community is very, very, we need it. We mm-hmm. definitely, definitely need it. And I've actually been to Sandra Hess, shows some years ago,
Sandra Hurst, she's powerful, isn't she? So yeah, I've seen her in action, very beautiful.
She was talking about the sex transmutation. That
mm-hmm.
is very, very, very interesting as well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I just want to add a bit of spin on that, because I was saying earlier, a lot of the important things in life, no one really educates us about it. For example, money,
mm-hmm.
no one really teaches us about how money works, and sex as well.
That's right. You know, the two important things in our lives, yeah.
These are the most important things,
mm-hmm.
because everybody have to involve in these two aspects of life. Either one,
sooner
every day
or later, they do, don't they? Yeah.
Yes. So, I wonder why is such a taboo subject that nobody really talks about, and yet it is controlling our life all the time.
For sure.
You know, most of our youth and even adults just get engaged in sexual activities anyhow without trying to study the subject. You know, like Auntie Robin said, if you want to understand anything, you've got to study it.
You've got to study it. Exactly. I mean, what would you say? What's your take? How would you say, what would be the best approach for parents, for people to start, you know, engaging their children in conversation about, you know, relationships and money and all these things? Where would you say, where would you say is the best way to start, the best age, the best time to start talking to young people about these types of things?
I think right now, I have to learn a lot of these things myself. And probably the best thing for parents is to start getting involved in probably like seminars or even any kind of institutions or organizations or you know, which we do offer some of this. I do blog a lot about this kind of subject as well to learn, because it's hard. You can't really go to like school to learn these things. If it has to be something that you have to engage on yourself as a mother, as a father, or even as a young person, to learn it yourself.
That's right, that's right.
In terms of game books that relate to that kind of subject. And I think it's going to be like, or get, you know, getting involved with communities that can teach you this this kind of subject, because the institutions or the governments are not interested in really teaching the average person about money, because the system works in the way that the way the system works is the more you can keep more people ignorant and confused about certain subjects, then it makes it easy for the ruling elite. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay, so I get from that you're saying there needs to be sort of a mass group of people that are dumbed down, and they have been like sort of used to keep the system going for the few. Is that how you would is that what you're saying?
Yes, because we are all creators. You know what I'm saying? We are all creators. We can all create from within ourselves. But the thing is, because the average person, especially most of our people, do not understand our own self. We don't understand our own what is a human being. What is this thing, this being that we call human being? We can all create whatever we want to create. Like the sister Sandra Hess is talking in that audio about sex transmutation. It's one of it, because look at it this way. If
I was going to say that's creative energy, whether you use it to make children or whether you use it to make, you know, to create things, you know, get the ideas coming through and creating tangible things that we can see.
Yes, but this is the art. This is the knowledge that we haven't got access to anymore.
That's right.
All we know is it's just the recreational sex. And that comes from the Eurocentric way of teaching. You understand?
Hello? Yeah, you don't know. Carry on, Mr. Hash. We're expecting a guest, but just carry on. We will.
Okay. So the point I was trying to say is, if a child can be created out of sex, it means that we can, that same energy, we can use it to create whatever we want. We can use it to create whatever we want, whether it's a business, money, whatever.
Exactly.
We can use the same sexual energy, because it's a creative energy.
Exactly.
It's a creative energy, but right now, the masses or most people are just using it we're just wasting energy.
Yeah, it's like it's going nowhere. It's not doing anything for us at all. It's just
we're using it for lust. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with that.
And these are the things that we, you know, I'm basically telling the listeners out there to I teach this kind of subject about entrepreneurship, and even that's another thing. You know, what does it take to become an entrepreneur?
We're going to have to get you in, Mr. Hash. We have to get you in to come and speak to the audience. So what you're saying is you would like to Do you want to leave any details for people to speak more to you about this?
Yeah, okay, I can leave my details. You know, I've got a blog platform that I would definitely really like a lot of people, like listeners, out there to check it and mm-hmm. see how they can using it, because the business of the 21st century mm-hmm. is the internet. You know,
you can start
a business so small mm-hmm. from any level, from the comfort of your own home, as long as your voice, you can get your voice out there.
Mm-hmm.
You can create a big business out of that. And this is the kind of thing that I teach people, what entrepreneurship is all about.
That's right.
You know, how can you, whatever business you're involved in, whether you, even if it's a book, whether if you've written a book and you want it to reach the world, you know what I'm saying? Whatever it is that you've got that you want to, because the most challenges the black community have is we do not understand marketing. You understand?
Mr. Hash, I totally agree with that because... like I was saying earlier on, you know, with everyone comes here with gifts, everyone comes here with talents, but in order for anyone to see those gifts and talents, they need to be marketed really, really well. And in terms of marketing, I would definitely say it has to be, you know, you have to find, you know, there's all these tools, but we don't really know how to use them. So, you know, you're absolutely right. So, do you want to leave your details? Because what we're going to do, yes.
Yes, basically what I'm involved in is marketing, you know, by internet marketing, which means that whatever business you've got out there, whether it's a book, whether you're a minister, you've got a ministry, you want to reach the world, whatever mm-hmm. it is, whatever it is that, you know, it's, because it's all about marketing, your business is as good as the best, as big as how far you can market that business.
That's
how you
right.
can communicate with the world. And that is what I'm specialized on. And anyone, listeners out there want to get in touch, they can get in touch through is www.empowernetwork.
Mm-hmm.
Empower Network, you know, like empowering people, empowernetwork.
Okay. Yeah.
.com/hash, H-A-S-H.
Okay.
H for Harry, mm-hmm. A for Apple, S for Sugar, H for Harry. That's /hash. empowernetwork.com/hash.
Okay. Mr. Hash, what are we going to do? We're going to, because we've got our special guest in the studio. So okay. we're going to go. So I hope you're going to continue listening to the show, yeah?
Yeah, I'm going to, you know, you're doing a good work and big up the whole household, Nubia House.
Brilliant. Yeah, you've got to listen. We've got this.
Everybody.
Yeah.
Good, keep up with the good work. I really
Thank
like
you.
It.
Thank you.
I like it. Yeah?
Thank you. And you take care. Thank
take
you so
care.
Much
take
for calling
care.
In. Okay. Take care. Okay. Hello, listeners. My special guest is in the house. He's going to say a quick hello and then we're going to play one track just to get him going and then we're going to start the show. So. My dear Orlando, please say hello.
Hello. Hi, how are you? I haven't seen you for years. You're still looking fresh.
Oh, my
fresh
God.
Fresh Anubian.
You're
hello.
So funny. I know. We go back so long.
We go back a long, long, long way. Not that I'm that old, of course. I've known her since she was about one.
Oh, do you want to go straight into the interview? Or should we play a song?
Yeah, of course. Yeah? That's up to you.
Yeah, we'll go ahead. Just introduce yourself. He's fantastic. He's so talented. He's so gifted. You've got to.
I'm blushing now.
Okay. Go on.
Hi,
Matt, I'm going to shut up.
The name's Orlando. I run a record company and a musical promotions company, concert promotion company called Musical Therapy Entertainment. We specialise in concerts for the, I would say, predominantly over 30s, quality soul and quality reggae. All of the shows are conducted either at the Indigo 02 in Greenwich or the Jazz Cafe in Camden. So that's me. I was going to plug, but I can't plug it, can I?
What's that?
I was going to plug my show.
Yep.
Would that be too shameless? Would that be shameless? Or should I wait till the end? Let me wait till the end.
Right,
let's just talk generally.
You know what you can tell?
At least I'm honest.
You know what you can tell about? Tell me about that event that's going on the 18th, or is it the 19th?
19th of October.
Yeah.
Okay. I've got an event on the 19th of October at the Indigo, Giants and Lovers Rock, Part 6.
Let them know that you're the person behind it, because I saw this giant Lovers Rock stuff. I didn't know you were behind all that until we got talking recently.
Well, Lovers Rock has always been like a fabric of my life.
Same here.
For a lot of us, like born in Britain, mm-hmm. black, you know, it's always not just black, actually, for anyone from the urban kind of background.
Mm-hmm.
So a few years ago, I had the opportunity to start managing some of the legends from the industry, like Janet Kay, Carol Thompson, love Peter Janet Honeygill. Kent.
I grew up with those girls, yeah. You know, in terms of listening to them.
There you go.
We all did. I used to love a lady and I used to want to be like that and I used to try and get a note out, but it wasn't quite
the high
right.
Note, yeah. I only got that in the high note when I got
that. You know,
that
bit, silly girl, silly girl.
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one, yeah.
Cat, yeah.
And that note is still famous till this very day. Every time she does a show, the whole audience, just before we come to it, she says, right then, I'm ready for everyone ready, and then you find out who the...
And you know what I love about them? Their humility, because I've watched them on interviews on YouTube, and they're so... Yeah, are they like that in...
They really are. I mean, the girls are so grounded, so down to earth. But a lot of the people in that field really are.
Wow.
They came from a background where maybe they wasn't appreciated as much as they could have been.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But they've still done great work and they're probably getting the fruits of the labour now.
Mm. You know what I mean? Which is good, isn't it? Oh my God.
It's
so
good.
You know, Orlando, I mean, I've known you for a long time and, you know, I met you, do you remember when we did, what was it? We were studying at college, wasn't it? What was it called? Not philosophy, was it philosophy?
I think it was philosophy, actually. I don't ask you why, but I was
in philosophy. You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm always like learning, I've always liked different things. And, you know, and I remember meeting you, so much energy and so many ideas and, you know, just a wonderful spirit. And you're just the same today. And I remember we met as well a few years back when you had, I can't remember the name of the gentleman you had on.
Wayne Marshall.
Might have been, yeah.
Yeah, Wayne Marshall,
It was just so nice seeing you. You're still the same bubbly person.
I think intrinsically people stay the same. Mm-hmm. I think circumstances might change it, but... Inside, you're the same person, like through. I've been the same since I was, I think, 12, to be honest with you.
Wow.
I haven't grown much either.
But you know, you are fine as you are, really. But you know what I'd say to you is, like, a listening audience, this show is primarily about personal development and self-empowerment and self-achievement. And what I want you to do is just really tell people, you know, that if they're sitting at home and they've got ideas, they've got gifts, just can you just give them some words to just sort of say, you know, how you got out and successful?
Okay. I think the most important thing, I think we all have ideas, we all have dreams, we all have aspirations.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing separating most people is those who try to do it and show those people who just talk about it.
Mm.
My thing is, I've never been frightened to fail, but I've always been frightened not to try.
Oh, God, that is powerful. Say that again. No, seriously. Because that's the thing. That's the thing. You know, like for me personally, for a long time, that's the thing. I'm always scared about what people's going to think.
No.
And this year, I've just come out.
You just go for it.
Yeah.
You go for it. Because ultimately, to be honest with you, that's always been my mantra anyway. Mm-hmm. Just always try. You get an idea, try to make it work. If it doesn't work, guess what? Millions of other people's ideas don't work. It doesn't really matter.
That's right.
But rather to have tried and failed than to have tried at all.
Mm-hmm.
And that's I've kind of like lived by that.
Wow, you know what I mean? That's powerful.
Obviously, you still have to put in place basic edicts to make sure that it's got a greater opportunity of working.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if any plan you put in should always have a beginning, a middle, and an end.
For sure.
Do you know what I mean? Sure. But once you've done that, then go for it. And sometimes, if you want to say, I don't know, let's say you want to do a housing project, you might not be able to buy the whole estate, but you might be able to buy a part of it.
Or that's right.
Put with some other people and buy a brick.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got to start from somewhere. But always try to put your dreams into operation. Always try to make it work. And always try to think bigger than everyone else.
Wow, so you're saying that thing that we've always heard, dream for the stars, go as big as you want.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Your thing is not just go for, you know, I can just do this little thing here.
If you can conceive it, you can do it. I'll give a prime example, the show on the 19th of October, it's got over 20 acts on the bill. And, you know, when I first started doing it, people were saying, well, you won't be able to manage that, and how are you going to fit them in all at night, and blah, 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 blah. And I said, well, you know, I said, that part of it I can deal with. But the most important part of it, as far as I was concerned, what would give it a selling point, is that the public will look at it and say, for £25, they're getting so many acts.
Wow.
That's a night I can't miss.
So that is next weekend, isn't it?
Next weekend, so next Saturday.
Next weekend, I definitely want. So please, can you just tell, what would people need to do if they want to get tickets and things?
If you want to buy tickets, you can, if you're based in Tottenham, you could go to Everybody's Music, which is just up the road by...
It's called Everybody's Music?
Yeah, it used to be called Body Music.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, the one of Seven Sisters Run. Okay. I think you just moved to a smaller seven. But obviously, if you're going to buy it online, the company to go to is axs.com. That's A for Apple, X for X-ray, S for Sierra, .com. And that's for credit card and debit card bookings. Or if you want to pay by PayPal, which a lot of people do nowadays because of eBay.
I'm a PayPal fan.
Then if you visit my website, which is www.musicaltherapy.com. That's therapy entertainment.com. So that's musicaltherapyentertainment.com, and you'll see tickets and you'll see the events that I've got going at the moment. And lowest, cheapest booking fee too.
Well, one of the things I'll say, I'm really glad that you got here, because I know you're really busy, and I don't think you're local, are you? You don't...
No, I'm Brixton.
Wow, so, you know, once again, thank you so much for making it over.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what's your plans, or how do you actually, when you get a big project like what you're doing, what's the first thing you do? Because, you know, a lot of the people that are listening, they're into, you know, they want
events,
to, and they want to succeed and do things, you know, to empower their lives.
Okay.
So give us a little bit of a step by step.
Okay.
Yeah.
If we stick within, you know, my speciality, which is shows and blah, blah. Basically, if I want to put on a show now, the three kind of things I look for is obviously the content, which is the artist, whether I can afford them, and whether or not they're going to attract the kind of audience that I need to pull in.
Right.
The venue, obviously, the type of venue that it is, where it's located, how much it's going to cost me, and whether or not it's the kind of venue that people like going to.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's another part of it. Obviously, it's got to make sure that it works within that, you know, and ultimately, at the end of it all, whether I can put it on at a price that people can afford, but still make sure there's a margin in it, so that if it does work and it's successful, I can move on to the next one.
Wow.
I mean,
so to get to where you were now, was it a bit of trial and error, or did you start off, you know, because I'm kind of playing devil's advocate, I mean,
to give you a quick, you know, 1 minute thing, I mean, back in the day, which was like late 80s, I used to have an insurance brokerage, so I was far, far removed from
this type of thing.
Mm-hmm. But I started going out with a girl that was a singer,
right?
And at the time, with a lot of singers, she was experiencing difficulties getting paid.
Oh no.
And it was just at the beginning of the financial crash, the whole kind of regulation of financial industries. But to cut a longer story short, I said, okay, I'm going to come out of this game, and I was looking for someone else to go into.
Right.
And she was a singer. I was going out with her, was living together, and I thought, okay, you know what? I'm going to go in the music business.
Wow.
I write music. And it was really as simple as that. So I sat down and put a plan in my mind, and that's what I put into operation. I opened up a record company, Soultown Records. Had, back in the day, lots of different artists on the label as well, from Maxine and Zushi and Rick Clark and Wayne Marshall and Everest and Mary Rose, lots of different artists. And for a little while, it was really, really successful. So I came into the time when the British street soul thing was quite big.
Yes, yeah.
The Omar and people like that. So we've done really well back then. You know what I mean? And it just seemed like a natural progression, really, to move into, like, you know, musical management. Because obviously, when the download start situation happened, for a lot of people on the independent scene, especially at the very beginning, it killed it. You know, before you could make a record, take it from the pressing plant, take it straight into the shops, turn over money straight away, and go back into the studio and make another record. Those days died.
Wow.
And from, like, you know, heights when I was, you know, I sold like 100,000 copies of an album, of the Wayne Marshall album, we was going down to, you know, towards the end of, I was lucky if we sold 300 copies. So it totally changed the game.
So different.
Yeah, it totally changed the game. But what I realised back then is that people would still be booking artists for live shows. The video didn't kill that off. So I went into management.
Fantastic.
And then from the management, it was, you know, just progression onto putting on shows. Because, you know, people still like going out, and it doesn't matter how much recession there is, they still like going out. So
what I'm hearing there, you took what could have been an adversity and you turned it into a successful, now this is a successful thing that you've been doing for some time now. That's amazing.
I think I've always been a believer in taking that leap of faith. You know, when I first left school, I used to work for the Ministry of Defence, and one time I bought
a
book.
That's a very different world, isn't it? Yeah, my God. Yeah.
Absolutely, and especially in those days. I think my telephone's probably got more computer memory than what the whole of MOD had back then. It was a long time ago. I bought a book, if I'm talking about empowerment, called The Magic of Thinking Big by Dr. Schwartz.
Yes, I've heard of that, but I've never read it, but I've heard of it.
Absolutely brilliant book.
It's worth reading, I take it.
It changed my life.
Wow.
I was reading it because, you know, to make some extra money, I started doing telesales for a double glazing
company. I did that with them.
Okay, yeah. I think we've all been there.
Oh my God, people, the things I'm telling you, I've tried, oh my word.
Yeah,
yes.
No.
I did that.
It all kind of makes us who we are.
18 years old, knocking on doors.
Yeah, that's right. Oh,
do you want some double glazing?
I was quite good at it too.
Oh my word, yeah, go on.
So I was doing that in the evenings, part-time, and I was working for the Ministry of Defence, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. And at the time, there wasn't a lot of black people in the MOD, if I remember correctly. But, you know, there's a little group of us, but that was it. And one of the ladies that was running the telesales room, she was talking about this book called The Magic of Thinking Big.
Wow.
So I bought it, and I read it one weekend. And it had a line in it that said that, you know, you've got to follow your dreams, and the best way of going forward is to burn all the bridges behind you.
You know what? I keep hearing this. Don't have a plan B.
That's sink or
don't
swim.
Don't have a plan B.
Sink or swim. In other words, take that chance. Mm-hmm. There's no going back. Mm-hmm. So the only way you can do that is cut off what you've got. Then that way you have to make it work.
Oh my God.
Because the old survival instinct kicks in, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So you know, to tell you a story, it's quite interesting.
Please do.
I bought the book on a Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
And I read it on the Friday and the Saturday. Mm-hmm. And the Sunday. Mm-hmm. And the Monday I went and gave my notice.
As simple as that.
Yep.
Wicked.
Yeah, when I gave my notes. And,
imagine if you didn't, you would probably still be there now.
I'd probably be the most frustrated person ever, right?
Because it's not your personality. Your personality is very, you've got a very big personality.
Yeah, so it wouldn't have suited me at all anyway.
Mm-mm.
But, you know, in those days, it was, you know, you had a job.
Of course. You know, and I bet your parents were really proud as well.
I ain't working from Barbados.
I know, all those little, what do they call them? The little government jobs.
Yeah. That was that was brilliant as far as they were concerned, you know what I mean? So it was a big step.
Of course.
But really, it's a step that I think you have to follow your heart and you have to follow your dream.
When you did that, did you wake up the next day and think, oh my God, what have I done? Or did you feel,
it's really, once I made up my mind I was going to do it, mm-hmm. I was going to do it, and I went into double glazing full time.
Wow.
I went into the double glazing full time and I'd done it for at least 6 years.
I don't think I'm in the end of my own company.
I had 100 reps working for me, mm-hmm. with canvases and everything, mm-hmm. in 5 years. And then it went bust.
As they
Those
do.
Are the days.
But then do you kind of see a trail when you look at your life now? Do you kind of think all these little things, even that going bust, do you think that, again, that took you to the next step?
Listen, you know what I realise is that nobody gets to where they're getting to, mm-hmm. without failure.
Of course.
Failure to success turn inside
That's
out. Right. You have to fail to succeed.
That's right.
How do you learn? You have to fail to succeed.
Absolutely.
It's just law of nature.
Mm-hmm.
So don't be frightened of it. Embrace it.
For sure.
Just learn from it and make sure it doesn't happen again. You know, make sure it doesn't happen again for the same reasons.
It's all right to have different problems, so don't keep repeating the same one.
Yeah, because if you keep repeating the same one, then you haven't learned.
You haven't learned, and that's
so,
no good.
You know, and that's, you know, that's the basic remit of making mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that time you made a mistake on that, I won't do that again. Something else will come up, mm-hmm. and you learn. And as you get older as well, you start seeing things from further away.
Wow.
You know, I can actually sit back now and say, if you don't do this, you're going to have a problem, mm-hmm. then.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas before, you would, you know, you're kind of rushing along doing it intuitively, but it's different now.
Wow.
It comes with experience. Always listen to people that are older and more wiser than you. It works.
Sure.
It works.
Wow. You know what I want to ask you quickly? Mm. We're going to go back and forth because I think there's
so much.
I want to ask you a little bit about who, you know, if people want to, are going to be going next week, who can they be expecting to see?
Well, we've got, as I said, there's 20 acts, so.
That's what I mean. That's
if I leave anybody
how
out, please forgive me.
You know what I mean? You're going to start something here, isn't it?
Well, the doors open at 6 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
If anyone who goes to my shows know, it starts promptly. It starts at 7 o'clock and it'll go through to 11:30.
Wow.
And on the night, it's the cream of the lovers rock. You've got, and also a special guest of the night is Frankie Paul.
Wow. Yeah,
Frankie Paul's our special guest.
Oh my God.
And for the first time
is
ever.
Is he singing Sarah?
Of course. Of course.
Yeah,
he's
doing
it.
Yeah,
I've got the set list. He's singing all of the hits.
He'll be.
And it's been funny enough, mm-hmm. his birthday's on the 19th as well.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So it's a double celebration. It's like
Fantastic.
A proper celebration. So we've got Frankie Paul. And for the first time, he'll be performing with the Reggae Philharmonic Orchestra.
Oh.
So, yeah. So, as I've recently just done the John Holt concert.
When I'd spoken to you, that had already happened,
that's
didn't
right.
it?
Yeah, just happened at
love
that.
John Holt.
Beginning
grew
of August.
Up on him, yeah.
And that was with the orchestra, and it went down really well.
Fantastic.
But the difference is with John Holt's music, obviously, it lent itself to the orchestral kind of arrangements,
mm-hmm.
because of 1,000 Volts of Holt's Light. Whereas with Frankie Paul's, he's mostly known for singing really melodically, but on Rora beats. Frankie Dancehall Paul. So for the first time, there'll be like orchestral arrangements with the dancehall kind of range
sort of
on his tune.
Wow.
So it's going to be an absolutely different kind of experience.
Wow.
It'll be the first time ever. It'll be worthwhile coming. Supporting Frankie, obviously, as I said, there's lots of acts on the bill. We've got Kofi. We've got Peter Huntingill.
Wow.
We've got Winston Reedy. We've got Vivian Jones. We've got Michael Gordon from
this
the
This is like the story of my young life.
Oh, absolutely. Everyone's on there.
The bill, you know.
Cassandra.
Like
we've got Sandra Cross.
Wow.
We've got Winston. We've got Paulette Tarja. We've got Tradition. We've got Paul Dawkins. We've got... We've got Mike Bentley, we've got Don Campbell.
Can you imagine you're gonna get a text? You leave me out. You know
we've got so many artists.
Wow.
We've got so many. We've got the cream of Lovers Rock.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if Lovers Rock form part of your life,
mm-hmm.
then really you can't really go wrong with this concert. And in between keeping the blend going is mm-hmm. Eddie Nesta and Robbie G. They're my resident
right,
hosts.
Right, fantastic.
So you have it's a great night. Mm-hmm. The place is great as well because obviously it's at the O2, mm-hmm. part of the actual arena.
Wow.
As you know, there's about 50 restaurants and mm-hmm. blah, blah, so you can make a really great experience.
Fantastic.
A lot of people bring their family out, their mums mm-hmm. and their dads and mm-hmm. blah, blah, and it's just a great experience.
Sounds lovely.
It's number six, so it happens. My artists always turn up as well. Hint, hint to the promoters of not doing
okay. So people listen, you know, that's, you know, because like Orlando, he's, you know, he's not, he's kind of showing you that he's taken a step, he's gone for his big dream and he's doing something. And what's really great as well, Orlando, you're, you know, you're getting our people out there, you know,
yeah,
who probably yeah. would not.
Yeah, I think yeah. for a lot of the artists.
That's what I'm really fascinated with.
This is the biggest platform for a lot of the artists that they've yes. ever performed in.
Yes.
And it's almost like once, you know, one lady sent them to me, a girl called Donna Roden, said to me, you know, Orlando, I was in the business for a long, long
mm-hmm,
time,
mm-hmm.
and I never really felt I would reap the kind of rewards I could have done. But the fact that I'm getting it now,
yes.
at this late stage of my life, has mm-hmm. made it all worthwhile.
For sure.
And a few people have said that to me. And that's another thing is I think that if you can do something
mm-hmm.
that other people are benefiting out of it,
thank you,
then
yes.
the universe will always support you. And I'm, that might sound a bit,
No.
But I really believe
we
in that.
We believe that
yeah,
here.
Yeah, I believe, yeah,
we,
I really
honestly,
believe that. Yeah,
so true.
Yeah.
If you
the universe
put, you have to go.
Yeah, you have to. If you're taking out, you've got to put back in.
That's right.
Yeah. So,
wow.
Yeah, the universe will bless you in different ways.
What I want
yeah.
to ask you, if there's somebody out there, say there's a budding Orlando
yeah.
type
mm.
person,
mm.
and they want to kind of know how do they get started
mm.
saying what you're doing
mm.
or, you know, how what would you say to them?
Well, firstly, I would get in touch with somebody.
Do you train people to do what
yeah,
you do?
Yeah, I let people shadow me. I've got
oh,
three people shadowing
you.
Me.
Seriously?
Yeah, I've got
no,
three
it's
people,
fascinating.
I've got three people shadowing me all the time. I
wow.
always give new people a chance because I'm a great believer in that as well because I think I've given a start to lots and lots of different people in
that
lots of different
brilliant.
Areas in the business
mm.
because I think you should always invest in people and give them the opportunity to do it and inspire them with confidence
mm-hmm,
to do it. I'm
mm-hmm.
a great believer in
mm-hmm,
that.
Mm-hmm.
Great believer in that. I mean, so if you want to go into a particular field, always look for somebody who's already doing what you're doing
yeah.
and just approach them. You know, if
mm-hmm.
you say to them, if you say to most people, you know, this I've got a dream and I want to be just like you, pamper the ego a little bit, stroke the ego,
mm-hmm,
yeah,
mm-hmm.
you want to be like me, okay, mini me.
Mm-hmm.
So let them, you know, just approach somebody and say,
mm-hmm.
do you mind if I do an unofficial internship, if you want to call it,
mm-hmm.
or apprenticeship or
mm-hmm,
whatever?
Mm-hmm.
Don't ask for money
mm-hmm,
until
mm-hmm.
you prove your worth.
Very good. Yeah.
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 To be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
So the person will look at it and say, well, you know what, apart from my time,
mm-hmm.
why not?
So they
you'd
would
be surprised.
Just, so they would shadow you and everything
yeah,
you're doing,
they just come
pertaining
yeah,
to...
Yeah, that's right. You know, or I'd put them in the right places to
mm-hmm.
work with people that would
mm-hmm.
get some benefit out of. Because
mm-hmm.
obviously, at the end of the day, it's very difficult to impart, like, 53 years worth of knowledge on somebody just like that,
mm-hmm,
blah, blah,
mm-hmm,
blah.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they're shadowing you, because,
mm-hmm.
you know, a lot of the things we do as people who are self-employed in
mm-hmm.
business is kind of intuitive.
Yes.
And you know, sometimes it's not set guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
You would actually react to something as it comes up, and it's sometimes
mm-hmm.
very hard to teach somebody. Do you know what I mean?
For sure. Can you please just say your details again, just in
yeah.
case someone steps
so
in or just switched on to us?
Yeah,
yeah?
It's Orlando Gittens from musicaltherapyentertainment.com.
And that's a great website. I've looked at websites, so much information there.
Yeah.
So, you know,
yeah. And I'm going to build it as
website.
Well. Yeah, we're going to do more and more to it as well, actually.
Beautiful website,
yeah.
yeah.
You'll find most of the things on there as well, the kind of artists that we look after,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and a little bit about myself, a bit forthcoming events, you know, and also we've got a marketing and consultancy area on that as well, which we're developing as well for other people who want to come into the business
mm-hmm.
at a little stage further and they just need someone to hold their hand. We offer that service as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So people can get in touch and, you know,
absolutely.
Even just leave like
yeah.
names on lists.
Musicaltherapyentertainment.com.
I love that title. What made you choose that title?
I don't know. It's really weird. Sometimes you just go to bed
mm.
and you wake up in the morning and something's in your head.
Something
thought,
just, an
and
idea
I thought,
just
I
pops.
Really like that. I
yeah.
like musical therapy. That's,
mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. It's just weird. I just wanted to come up and it just stuck with me. I thought it works in so many different ways as
mm-hmm.
well because obviously... I find music very therapeutic anyway.
Me too.
If I feel really upset about something, music can
me
soothe
too.
Me. If I feel too placid, music could
that's
fire
I,
me
you
up.
You know what,
yeah.
I drive around and I'm singing in my car. And sometimes people see me, they're waving.
Yeah, yeah,
do you do
yeah,
that?
Yeah,
I'm
absolutely, yeah.
I'm singing and,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
moving
yeah.
and... I don't,
yeah.
you know, traffic
music
doesn't
is great.
Yes.
Music
changes
is great.
Changes your state.
It definitely changes your state, absolutely.
Mm.
Yeah, it connects with all of us. It doesn't matter what kind of music we like.
Mm.
You know, music is the only form of
yeah.
thing that can make you feel... really, really
that's
happy amazing. At one moment, really, really sad at the other.
Yeah. And what does it mean for us to support these talented people
yeah.
going to the events and stuff?
Well, you know,
what does
you know, my vibe is if you would like somebody to support you mm-hmm. for what you do, then you shouldn't feel any kind of way of supporting somebody else in what they do. You get what you put in. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's something that you like, no one's saying to you to come to support something that you don't believe in or mm-hmm. you don't like. Of mm-hmm. course not. Mm-hmm. But if you do like it, then really give it a chance. Support it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because then somebody's more likely to support you.
For sure. So yeah. It's like, you know, give out what you want to receive.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, and to be honest, I specialise in black music because I'm fiercely proud of being black.
What's your favourite kind? I kind of know what it is, but just tell the audience, yeah. What's your favourite kind of music? I know reggae's one.
I like old school.
Mm,
I
me
like
too.
Soul. Mm. I like all of, like, soul and R&B, probably
yeah, before
up to
you,
the, up
before
to the
you
90s.
Came in, I was playing a lot of our rear grooves.
Oh, right, yeah, of course, yeah. So I've done some big rear groove concerts, giants of rear groove.
Yeah,
I've
tell had, us like, a little bit about
I've
that.
I've had Leroy Hutson, I've had the Emotions, I've
so,
had
hold on.
Barbara Mason.
So you got them to come over and do
Yeah, I've done quite a few
Barbara,
concerts.
Barbara Mason, somebody, she's 16, no, she does, yeah. Those talk banks.
Yeah, that's right, yeah, that's right, that's right, that's right. Yeah, yeah, Time Crisis, all that. She's great, I've had... the Jones Girls.
I love the Jones
Sherry
Girls.
Sherry Jones is one of my good friends. We've had.
How was it for you? Because, you know, you like me were growing up listening to these things.
Yeah.
On, how was it when you kind of met these people?
You know.
And you were making
yeah,
their dreams come true
yeah,
again.
Yeah. At this stage, it's weird because, you. It's only sometimes you're doing something and, when the artist comes over and you're sitting down, and you're talking to them and you say, oh yeah, I've got your record. I bought your record. Blah blah blah. And especially for the Lovers Rock one, it's really weird because Carol Thompson.
Aww.
I used to go when I was like 20.
She seems really
yeah,
sweet. Yeah,
she's brilliant.
Yeah.
Well, she had you know Hopeless in Love. Everyone knows Hopeless
oh
in Love.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
And I was going out with a girl at the time. I was thinking about 19 or 20,
oh.
And we was in love. Hello.
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful girl. We was in love,
oh, no.
And whenever we was at a dance or a party or wherever it was back in the day, the
that
old
song
time
was
club,
playing somewhere.
We had to find each other. That was
aww.
Like the unspoken. So I could be one part in the country,
mm-hmm.
And we have to find each other. So when I started first looking after Carol, it was like I said, Carol, you're not going to believe. I said. Your record
helped
was a
you.
Massive part of my life. I said, and now I see you all the time,
yeah.
And when we're working with you and blah blah. But when we do concerts or do shows, and she's singing, you see the whole place is singing.
I
that's
imagine.
When you realise
yeah,
that music was magic.
Yeah, that was our.
Yeah.
It was her
yeah.
song she wrote and sang.
Yeah,
but it was our
it was,
lives.
That's right.
Yeah.
We took it on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was, you know, it's Lovers Rock. Kind of, it's really weird. Back in the day, Lovers Rock was so kind of like innocent.
That's what, you know, when
yeah.
I listen to it now, you do think, oh my God, is that what we were
yeah,
talking about?
Yeah, it's like, oh, my boy, he's going to leave me
but
and he's going to come back and I'm in love.
You know, you saying that, what do you think, like, when you listen to the music today, that how kids
I feel, you know, it's almost,
kind of exposed to?
I'm going to put my hand up to something. I was, you know, when music changed over to being more rawer,
mm-hmm.
I was bang on, put this way, one of my biggest hits was a track called G-Spot with Wayne Marshall. So
okay,
you know
okay.
The whole kind of romanticism went out the window, and I was dealing with like hardcore kind of
oh my God.
Sexual matters, right? At the end of the day, and to be honest with you, at the time I was justifying it because it seemed to me that's the way we was going,
right.
And in my way it was like it was honest. It's like you know, boy meets girl,
mm-hmm.
And yeah, you want to buy her roses and flowers and blah blah blah, but. You know, there's other aspects.
I think those days were good, though.
They were brilliant.
The old
brilliant.
Roses
and the older
and
I've
flowers.
Got now, the older I've got now, the more I think I wish we could go back to that.
You know,
there's knowledge with hindsight, right?
But you know, you said you kind of tried that for a while, but it sounds to me as though you kind of realised, you know what, old school.
Well,
the
society changed,
mm-hmm.
And you know, people became more blunt.
Yeah.
You know, romance went out the window.
I'm not a prude, but I just think it's too much, isn't
well,
it?
Well, the problem is, it probably was. At one extreme,
yeah,
back in the day,
London,
yeah, and that's
innocent,
why the majority
yeah.
of people used to go to were girls in Lovers Rock scene. then the pendulum swung round to about halfway, and it was okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could be honest. So you know, first, oh, when I look in your eyes, I see the stars and all that. So it's like it moved away from that into a bit more of reality.
Mm.
But then it's gone completely the other side
yeah,
now,
too,
where it's like now you don't even have conversations.
Mm-mm.
It's like you know, this is what I want. This is what I'm looking for. Yeah, you're down. Let's link. So
yeah.
It's like, well, how do we go from here to there? That's like
it's
a bit
too
deep.
Much, isn't it?
Yeah.
And also, do
yeah.
you find like, I don't know if you're a parent now and that, but do
yeah.
you find that?
Well, two kids, yeah.
Oh, two kids.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Boy, girl. What
two boys. New boy, just born on the 1st of August.
Oh, I had a new grandbaby just born 2 weeks ago.
Oh, well, there you go.
I know.
Yeah. Denver's hair.
Yeah, no, we're sitting here like, talking about, you know, children and
yeah,
grandchildren.
Yeah.
But that's wonderful. But do you feel that since you've had children yourself, you're kind of even more. you know, conscious of what is...
You know, I'm more conscious of what the world would be like for them to grow up and live in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my oldest boy is like five,
oh,
Montana.
Oh, bless.
And, you know, he's a black boy, he lives in London,
oh.
And it's like, and I'm worried about what's happening to black boys in London.
Of course, of
you know,
course.
Whereas before I was doing my thing, but now I'm acutely aware of the fact that I'm so kind of tuned into absolutely everything now in regards to that. And it's like, well, I've got to put him in the best position possible.
For sure.
So he doesn't go that kind of way. But, you know, that's another conversation for another show.
Oh, yeah. But so carrying on from, you know, where we were for your shows and that, I know you've got something as well coming up. You've got things coming online.
Yeah, I've got.
I've looked at your site. And
Got. As I said, on the
you're kind of
9th
hooked
of October,
up, sort
of
thing.
Of course, you've got. Yeah, because I do shows for a living now, so it's not about living from one show to the other.
Mm-hmm.
Now you've got to plan ahead, because obviously there's got to be a period of time when you put it together, a period of time when you promote it, a period of time when you organise what's going to happen on the night.
Wow.
So you need time for that, and
is
I'm a great believer in the lead-in time.
Yeah. Is that stressful, or how do you have a team of people that kind of
The funny thing is, it's really, I do it myself.
I do everything.
I do it myself. But, you know, obviously on the night I've got a stage manager doing fantastic. I've got my technical guy who looks after, you know, the sound on the stage, Michael Daly. I've got a team that I've worked with for years, and I keep with them. But it's maybe because I've always been a great believer in, maybe I'm difficult to work with. Maybe
do you have like a PA type person, someone who's...
No.
You do all that?
I do everything, yeah.
Good.
Much to my detriment, actually. I wish I had somebody who could just do everything for me.
Wow.
Actually, it'd be brilliant, funny enough. But it's so difficult to find somebody that you can work with.
Yeah.
You can
tune see
into what
dreams,
you want.
Yes, and make
and,
it come.
Yeah, yeah. And sometimes you spend more time showing the person what to
you
do.
You might as well just do it.
You might as well do it yourself. And I'm a great player. And because I work very quickly and I'm very much kind of like the thought process, like switch on, I'm going to do this. So I would just go and do it.
Wow.
And sometimes you've got other people and you're asking them to do it and you're waiting for them and it doesn't happen.
2 weeks
and it's
later.
Like you're thinking, you know what, this is starting the whole process and I'm working with you, so I feel obligated to give you the space to do that, but it's not working. I've tried to work with a couple of people before in the past in different shows, and I always find it kind of a struggle like that because everyone works differently.
And you know how you want it to be from start to finish.
I totally understand what I want. Yeah.
Wow.
And that's the problem. And it's not just a process of, you know, basic organisation. There's a creative process as well, you know, where the left side of the brain kicks in, and I've kind of got funny ideas like that. So I've got different ways of thinking about it. So that's what I realised over the years. My thought process is slightly different.
Do you have a technique that works for you? Because, you know, some people, they're in the shower.
Mind mapping or...
Yeah, or,
okay,
or how ideas come into your head. Do you find that you have to go into some sort of zone?
It's just like a state.
Do you have a pen and pad by your bed? No.
An idea would come to me, and then, as I said, then, you know, the circuit board in my head just lights up, and I see these things, like things in my head, actually, and I think, blah, 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 blah. And then it almost becomes like it's polarised into black and white action. And in my mind, it's like the logical thing to do. But when I sometimes talk to somebody else about it, and they look at me like, what on earth are you talking about?
Wow.
But in my mind, it's like it's a logical thing to do. It's like it's really strange. I mean,
wow.
So I couldn't turn and say, I do like, in the shower's quite good.
Yes, I find, I'm always in the shower and something spectacular comes.
When it comes
like rummaging around.
Yeah, especially when it comes to like, you know, almost like that mind mapping thing, when you're trying to work out the most logical way to do something. When I'm in the shower, I might be in there for like 20 minutes.
And then
all of a sudden
suddenly,
it's like, right, I'm going to do this. Bam.
Yeah,
just get it done.
Wow.
Yeah.
And do you believe that the universe likes you to take action straight away? And do you do that straight away?
Absolutely.
So as soon as that idea comes,
Absolutely. As I said, if I have an idea, if I truly have an idea, then my next step is not how I'm going to make it happen, it's when I'm going to make it happen. And I'll just go and do it. And you know, it's weird because sometimes you're doing something and things aren't going well, and you know, we might be in a situation where the money's tight or whatever, things are going wrong. But the universe has got a funny way of making sure that you come out the other side.
You know, I totally
you know, it's
agree
really
with
it's
that.
Like when people say something like, well, how do you make your money? So you know what? When I first self-employed, I used to think, oh my God, what are you going to do if it doesn't work? But like 30, 40 years later, you're still doing it. And what you realise is just really weird. It will just when it becomes the darkest,
that is the
light will switch.
Yeah,
something happens. The universe would look after you.
That is where you surrender, isn't it?
Yeah.
You surrender and then let the universe take
and you know,
over.
And you know, people, whether you call it faith, whether you call it religion, mm-hmm. whether you call it karma, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. whatever, mm-hmm. however you want to choose mm-hmm, to call it, mm-hmm. there is definitely something there that looks after you.
For sure.
100%.
For sure. I mean, I don't know if you're not a religious person.
Not really,
but
no.
I would say I'm leaning
spiritual.
More spiritual.
Yeah, very spiritual, yeah.
So give us some you know, insight into you and your spiritual values.
I'm a great believer in karma. I believe that mm-hmm. you know if you do wrong, mm-hmm. it will find you, and you will get repaid. You know
for
what
sure.
I mean. So I think you should be guided by your conscience,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and your conscience. You know when you're doing wrong.
That's right.
So guess what? Just don't do it,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because you know you might think you've got away with it, but really,
it will come and
somewhere
bite
along
you.
The line,
yeah,
it
somewhere.
Will come, and mm-hmm. you'll sit there and say, "I knew I shouldn't have done that."
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
And when
no
you're conscious, perfect. When you're conscious, you know exactly where it's coming from.
Oh,
as well,
you
don't
do.
You?
Yeah, you do.
You kind of feel,
yeah.
like, God, 100%.
You know. When something comes up and you think and you get tempted to do something that's wrong,
mm-hmm.
really and truly, you know, life shows you that you might think you're getting away with it, you might get an immediate gratification, whatever you've done, but sooner or later
it's
it will
going
come
to
back
come
to you.
Back.
And when it comes back to you, it comes back properly and you're sitting back thinking, ruin the day that you're doing. And sometimes, you know, having a conscience, so when you go to bed and you think, nah, I'm not sleeping easy on that.
Mm.
I shouldn't have done that.
Yeah, I love to be able to go to sleep at night.
I
can't.
Yeah,
you know,
that's
I mean, right. if I got something with somebody, I'd like to. You know, you want to. Kind
yeah,
of get,
just clean
yeah.
it, clear it. So
or
it's
if
not
you've
there.
Done something, you think,
yeah.
oh my god, you know. Or if
yeah.
You know, it's something for yourself. You know, I shouldn't have done that. I should.
Absolutely.
You know, if I shouldn't
Absolutely.
Have eaten this thing, oh my god,
yeah.
you know, anything. But
yeah. So true.
I love that. I love your energy. It's just so strong, so powerful. Honestly, people, he's so lovely. Exactly, you're still the same. So,
yeah,
so
I
still
think
the same.
People stay the same.
Yeah.
I think people stay the same. I really, really do.
But what I want you to do, we're going down to the last few minutes, and I
yeah.
want you to kind of put some, I know you've put gem after gem after gem,
yeah.
but if there's anything that's kind of been your guiding thing, mm-hmm. whether it's a quote, whether it's something your mum and dad might have said to you
okay.
growing up that's made you the person you are. Can you just share with the people?
I would just sort of say, you know, don't quit.
Wow.
You know, whatever you want to do,
mm-hmm.
follow it through, and just don't quit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it's dark, it's always the darkest before it's light. So don't quit because
mm-hmm.
it's just around the corner.
Wow.
So follow your dream properly, take it all the way through. And when you think this can't work, push it just one more step further because
mm-hmm.
you'd be surprised what's around the corner.
Wow. Was that something that was instilled by your parents, or is that something
you
found on your journey?
I think it's come through my journey,
mm-hmm.
my last journey.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, your parents want you to do the best that you want to do, but a lot of us are coming from the Caribbean, parents come from the Caribbean, their main concern was putting food on the table.
For sure.
Okay, mum and dad worked full time.
Same here.
All
yeah.
the time,
mm-hmm.
scrimped and scraped to get,
mm-hmm.
you know, to get the house. So really,
mm-hmm.
the kind of lessons that I give my son now,
mm-hmm.
they never had the time to give me. But what they did instill me was like the basic principles of good family life,
mm.
which was the most important thing for me.
So would you say, if I said to you, what keeps you motivated to do what you do? What is the thing that stands out for you?
I think...
What gets you up in the morning to do what you do?
Well, I can tell you one thing, it's not money. I'm not motivated by
mm-hmm,
money.
Mm-hmm.
I'm motivated by getting satisfaction from what I'm doing
wow.
and being and trying to be successful
mm-hmm.
in what I'm doing. I believe that if you're successful at something, money is a byproduct of success
sure.
anyway, so you don't have to focus on that.
Mm-hmm.
And too many people focus on the money.
And also, it sounds like you're also tying success into other people's lives. That's
Absolutely.
Also,
yeah.
That seems to be
Again,
something.
You know, it's really, back in the day, there was a Jewish guy that used to, when I first started doing double glazing, he said to me, Orlando, billionaires are made by millionaires, and millionaires are made by people who make hundreds of thousands, and people who make hundreds of thousands are made by people who make thousands of pounds.
Wow.
There's always, everyone in the chain has to be paid
God,
for you to become successful.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always stood with me, it's stuck with me, it's like, well, you know what, everyone has to eat.
For sure.
Basically, everybody, you can't have it all for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody in what you're involved in has to eat,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because that's how it works.
Wow.
It's like a chain. And
so
you know,
cooperation, not competition.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely. You know, don't get me wrong, there's always going to be competition.
Yeah, but healthy.
Competition will hone you,
yeah.
you know, make you sharper. But
mm-hmm.
in reality, you should never get caught up in being malicious in the competition.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, just use it as a motivation. Oh, that's a great show. I'm going to do a better show than that.
Mm-hmm,
there's nothing
mm-hmm.
wrong with that.
Yes.
As opposed to, that's a great show, I really hate the person for doing that. That's wrong.
That is very wrong. That is so not part of our spiritual.
Can I just quick mention, I've got a couple more shows coming. I know that we're running out of time.
No, please,
yeah.
speak.
On
be
the,
my guest.
On the
be
first
my
of
guest.
No- I like that. On the 1st of November, I've got Old School Soul Gig
Woo.
With Archie Bell and the Drills.
I'm going to be there.
Glenn Jones,
wow.
Steve Arrington from Slave, and Loose Ends. That's on the 1st of November.
Loose Ends. They're a British group.
That's right. Oh, yeah. Wow. Of course, Kyle McIntosh and that, yeah.
Gosh.
That's on the 1st. Again, that's at the Indigo. Mm-hmm. Check the website. And on the 5th of December, we have Maxi Priest and Shaka Demus on
Pliers. Maxi Priest, wow. Yeah. Wow.
At the Shaka Indigo Demus. As well.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
And on the 13th of December, it's Old School Motown Christmas Party. Yeah.
I love Motown.
Yeah, don't we all?
Oh, you tell me, I grew up on
my
that.
My record company was called Soultown because it was inspired by Motown.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Do you kind of, I know we're going to go now, but do you, that other man, Berry Gordy, do you kind of feel
course.
A look?
Berry
do you,
Gordy,
do you like look yeah, at him and think, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Berry Gordy, I mean, I had the pleasure of meeting him once.
No.
And Berry Gordy was always, like, obviously, when I came to the music business, I said, my record company was called Soultown Records because it was based on the ideological principles of Motown Records.
Right,
you know,
yeah.
A group of talented people getting together, forming their own little company, from their own little industry, from producers to artists to... marketing, either all within a Soultown record kind of ethos, and it's all based on Motown.
Fantastic.
Very cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, just again, give out your details one more time because I really want people to,
so I
want to
say,
get there.
MusicalTherapyEntertainment.com. That's MusicalTherapyEntertainment.com, or call the radio station and I'll give it to you as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that, like, honestly, I'm just so glad that we've met up again, and you know we must definitely keep that link going.
No, we have to keep. You know, it's years of rolling back. Actually,
you must tell me, will you come back again?
I could say I used to fancy this girl, people. I'm gonna make a confession.
God.
I really, really did. I really, really, really did. And my heart's still beating now. And I feel like it's like love is all coming again. But anyway, sorry about that. Just had to get that.
Actually, are you married? What's going on with you? Tell us about your tell us about
married
your family.
Now, I've got two kids.
What's your wife's name?
Natasha.
Oh, fantastic! I'm so honestly, I'm sure that she's a very happy lady, because you've always got that bubbly smile,
we have our ups and
great
downs,
personality.
Yeah.
No, seriously, I'm really, really happy for you. Oh my God. So, anyway, we're gonna. This
Thank
is
you
it.
For having me.
Yeah. So you're gonna come back, aren't you?
100%.
And we are gonna stay in touch, aren't we?
Yeah. And you're coming to the show.
And I'm gonna come to a show.
Oh, well, there you go then. So we're definitely 100%.
Oh, that's brilliant.
100%.
Orlando. So people, I love you. Thank you so much for tuning in, and so thank you so much for being, you know, listening to my special guest. As you can hear, he's a wealth of knowledge, fantastic energy, beautiful spirit. And, you know, he will be back. And, you know, he's
Hit
doing
me up
great
on the
things.
Website.
He's doing great things in our community. So please, please, please support what he's doing. Because I know a lot of us have, you know, grown up listening to these people.
Absolutely.
And grown up listening to these people. And, hold on. I've got a few things I'm going to say before we go. Yeah, grown up listening to these people. So please support what Orlando's doing.
Thank you.
We have got great show, really positive, inspiring. We need more of the type of show in the community. I love what you're doing. And we also, before I go, we've got some names here. Yvonne, can you help me to shout out here? Yvonne. Oh, Yvonne J. Douglas. Hi, how are you? Thank you. We've also got Ken... Ken Hook. Can't read the writing. Hotep, I'm sorry. Kevin Harvey, Lyndon James, Sammy DK, Carl Williams, Mandy Gray, Anne Marie... Duncan, Lativa McQueen. Thank you all for listening to the show, and we're going to say goodbye. Please, Orlando, you say the last word.
Thank you for listening to the show. Thank you for taking some time out, and I will definitely be speaking to you again soon.
You will be back.
Yeah, I
Thank
shall
you.
Be back.
So we're going to play out with some of... what do you think of this song? Do you like I Believe in Miracles? By
Of course.
Shall we play that?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going, and we're going to play out with... The Jackson sisters, we believe in miracles, don't we?
I think we do.
Go on, you announce it.
We believe in miracles, we make miracles happen.
Yay!
Make me love.